Well, good evening, Oakland Baptist Church, and welcome to Keeping Your Toolshed in Order, Session 7. We're going to be talking about missions tonight. Last week, we talked about service, kind of a care orientation that all believers are responsible to do. And tonight, we're talking about that spiritual discipline of making disciples, i.e. missions. So let's go to the Lord in prayer before we go any further. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we can come and study your words and direct upon our heart to be able to share Christ with others. We love you. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Well, we all as Southern Baptists are very knowledgeable about missions. It's something that has helped start our denomination. It's something that has driven our denomination. Our denomination has two different kind of wings just focused on missions. That's the North American Mission Board that focuses on church planting and missions in the North America. And we have our missionaries that are sent overseas called the International Mission Board. And so that's kind of where when we give our offerings as a church, we give a percentage to these mission agencies. Why? Because it's important. And hopefully after today, you'll see why missions is an important thing. The word missions is something that's not in the Bible. If you look up missions in the back of your Bible, you will not find a scripture that says, go therefore and do missions. No, it won't say that. It's something that comes from a Latin word, missio, is the root, and it's come from 1598 when the Jesuits sent out missionaries. A missionary is a sent out one who is sent to share the gospel. That is the key. We see Paul sent out. We see all throughout the book of Acts where Paul and different other missionaries at times are sent to go and to share the gospel. And that is what we try to do as believers today when it comes to missions. Avery Willis, I don't know if you know him. If you've been a Baptist for a long time, you know him as a long-term missionary in Bangladesh. And we also see that he is the one who wrote Master Life, 1-2, and Master Builder, some great discipleship material that he used in the field. His definition of a believer's mission is the activity of God's people, the church, to proclaim the kingdom of God to the world. Now, last week we saw with service, that is to show God's love. So like if we give food, give clothing, that is showing God's love. But the key element of missions is proclaiming. You see the difference there? Now, here's the thing is you could be just passing out stuff, helping people out physically, and all of a sudden that service, that ministry, that care could transition to a mission perspective when you proclaim the gospel. And that's why it's important when we think about missions is that we think proclamation. Now, we're going to unpack this a little bit more because there's some depth to missions. It's not really what you think. I mean, if I was to be able to survey everybody and ask them what you think missions are, you would kind of write some stuff out. But missions is so much deeper. It's so much than just a person who's gone to another country. It is a lifestyle. So let's really look at some passages that talk about missions. One is the common denominator of all missions is that Matthew 28, 19 and 20. And hear what this word says from the word of our Lord. It says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Now, most people who have studied this passage have heard it preached often. You could ask them, what does this verse mean? What is the charge here? What is the command? And people will say, well, going is. That is incorrect. The command in this passage, if you look at the original language, is making disciples. That, my friends, is what we are charged to do. If we call ourselves disciples, if we call ourselves a disciple, I should say, then our charge is to make other disciples. Now, that can include many different perspectives. One, the first step is to share your faith. And so you share how to become a believer. And so if you lay that out there, then and they accept Christ, the next step is to disciple them or get somebody to disciple them. That is vital. And so the role here, that command that we see, is to make disciples. Now, the way these other verbs connect to the command is still promotes an importance, a pseudo command, something that is still to be done because of its attachment to making disciples. One, that is going. The going side is pretty much paints a picture that as we live our lives, we are to make disciples. Now, with missionaries, full-time missionaries, those who are called to go and make disciples in other countries, it is vital that we realize that that is their calling. And we're going to unpack that a little bit more. But as we talked about with spiritual gifts last week, we might not have that calling to go be an apostle, per se, to a missionary, one who is sent, but we are still called to go and make disciples. That might be in Bowling Green. That might be in your family, at your address. Whatever it might be, we are called to make disciples. We also see, if this is kind of stems to the Old Testament, a passage in Genesis 22:18. It says this: "All the nations of earth will be blessed by your offspring because you have obeyed my commands." I really wish I had the time. I mean, I could talk for 10 hours on the Old Testament concept of sending and missions. But you got to think, how do we bless all the nations? It's not money. It's not stuff. It's the gospel. If you're a believer, you will know that the most valuable way that we can bless other people is the gospel. So we are to make disciples as we go. It also says that we are to baptize. This is a command by association. This does not mean it's necessary. There are some denominations mean that you are not a believer until you are baptized. Well, that's not true. For us as Southern Baptists, we believe it is an act of obedience. We look at our Lord's life and we see our Lord get baptized. Well, that baptism didn't make him a believer. Why? Because he was God's son. So when we get baptized, we are showing that we are believing in Jesus, and we're emulating what he did to show the people around him also. But it says we are also to teach. We are to teach others. Again, this is a command by association, to share about what it means to be a believer. These classes that we've had every week, Sunday nights and Wednesday nights, these are teachings about discipleship. When we have these studies, we're growing and we're learning. And as believers, we should turn around and help others in that same way. You might say, well, I'm not a teacher. Well, did you understand the words that you read in God's Word? Well, you can share that. That's discipleship. Can you give somebody a shared link from another message that you heard that you liked and valued? Yes. Well, that is discipleship. Again, we are still charged to make disciples. So we are to make disciples as we go. We're to baptize other people. We are to teach them what your word says. Now, we see that is like the all faithful, the most important verse that we see pretty much in the New Testament when we talk about missions on why we are to go. And so, but there's another verse that's very common also, and that is the Acts 1:8. It kind of shows how we are to go. And so let's look at this verse. It says this: "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." There's no option there. If we have that Holy Spirit power within us, we will be the witnesses of Christ. Now think about that. If we have the Holy Spirit in us, we will be witnesses for Christ. Think about your life. Think about how you live it publicly. Think about how the words that you say publicly. Think about what you share about church publicly. Think about what you share about the gospel publicly. You know, we are to be witnesses on all those facets publicly. Now, what's the charge, the drive, the motivation, the encouragement, the energy, the strength that we do that with is the Holy Spirit. Now, you see, nobody's perfect. We know that's true. And we see many people will drop the ball. When they drop the ball, they're not focused on God. So when we see someone we know as a believer do something that is very unbeliever type of action or words, they're obviously not focused on God. They're not letting the Holy Spirit guide their lives. And that can be something that a lot of us deal with. I think all of us deal with. And that's where we need to repent. Again, you can go back a couple of lessons and look at that, but repenting is important because we want to be focused on how the Holy Spirit is guiding us. Listen to this quote from a missionary and mission speaker. His name is Lloyd Ogliff. He says, "The dynamic power of the Holy Spirit will be given in constant flow as long as we are engaged in communicating God's mission. We are to be conduits or channels, not reservoirs or holding tanks. A flowing river purifies itself. A swamp has inlets, but not outflows." And so we see right there, if one does not witness, make those disciples, share their faith, they can become spiritually stagnant. That's what Ogliff is saying, is if you do not share your faith, if you're not a disciple maker, you can become stagnant in your faith. And he uses that example with water. Well, think about water. I mean, we're in Kentucky. We got waters and ponds and creeks and rivers and lakes all around us. What happens when the water doesn't flow? It becomes stagnant. It becomes stinky. It becomes something that nobody wants to be around because of its quality. But those rivers, those creeks, those lakes, those ponds where it has water flowing in and flowing out, when it is flowing, then how beautiful is that picture? How life-bringing is that environment because of the flow of the water? Well, he's saying the Holy Spirit, when it flows through us, and so if it comes into us and we are immediately proclaiming it out to others, that is a very big life-bringing, a big strengthening, a big refreshment, a big part of our faith, because we are to be disciple makers. We are to witness into the world. And this is important for not only kingdom growth, but for our growth. And once we don't do that, we can become spiritually stagnant. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't want to be stagnant. People don't want to come to a stagnant church. People don't want to be around stagnant believers. We need to be with new life. We need to be the Holy Spirit flowing from us in our words and our actions that we proclaim Christ to others. Another verse that's very vital when it comes to missions is the Romans 10 passage, 14 and 15, and it says the following: "How then will they call on him in whom they are not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news." And this is a great kind of sketching of why we need to be sharing. How can people come to Christ? It is only through hearing the proclamation of the gospel, the good news of Jesus. Did you hear that? The only way your sister might come to faith is hearing the gospel. The only way your son can come to faith is hearing the gospel. And so that is a key thing that we have to keep in our mind, is the only way people around us can come to the Lord is through someone preaching the gospel. Now, this is what I want to unpack it to the next level, is because, yes, we are charged as believers to be disciple makers, but yet we also see right here that some are sent to preach. Now, I've been doing missions for a long time. I have my doctorate in missions, and it always melts my brain, and I just want to sit in ashes and rip my clothes like the Old Testament when I hear people say, well, why are we sending missionaries overseas when there's lots of people that don't know Jesus here? If spiritual gift of punching was available, I would claim it, because that's a person that does not know the gospel. Because here's the challenge, I would say. Now listen, I'm really stepping on some toes. Here's the challenge. Okay, if that's true, have you shared the gospel this week? Have you told someone about Jesus? Because that's part of the problem. Okay? Second, are you willing to go to Africa to share the gospel? That's another part of the problem. Third is this. You know how many Baptist churches we have in just this county? I mean, there's close to 60. If you look at other churches, there's close to 200 plus. Now, how many churches you think are in deep, say, sub-Saharan Africa? Zero. Zero. I can throw a stone from my back porch and hit a church. It's probably similar to you. You probably drive by churches every day. But how dare we say, well, why do we need to support missionaries overseas when we got problems here? Well, there's a thing that's called being a disciple maker and preaching yourself to those around you. There's so many more believers that are here versus overseas. So we need to get busy. You need to get busy. The second thing is we see in this passage right here is if you're not willing to preach and to go, then you need to send. That means you need to support. Again, the same thing happens. You hear people say, well, why are we supporting them? Well, it takes money to live. It takes money to go. I mean, how many missionaries do you know and have read stories and you see all throughout the time where missionaries had to come home because there was zero money? Or they died because there was zero money? We have to keep them on the field. The 5,000 missionaries that just the Southern Baptists have on the mission field, we have to keep them there because one, I know this, is that most of us are not willing to go. So we have to keep them there. Why? Because that's where they can hear the gospel. That is where they can hear the gospel. Some others might say, well, I don't want to give money to them because we're paying for administration costs. You know, it doesn't all go to the missionary. Well, listen, let me tell you, I know those people that do the administration, and they need to be where they are. What if the missionary had to deal with all the housing issues? What if the missionary had to deal with all kinds of visa issues and struggle issues with just the country? Well, the people that get paid for administration deal with those things. Why? To keep them in the field. And so this is very vital that we keep this in our mind. We can't just compartmentalize everything. We see right there in that Acts 1:8 passage that, yes, in our terms, we are called to Bowling Green. We are called to Warren County in Kentucky. We are called to our nation, but we're also called to the world. Whatever one you're not willing to go to, you need to send people by financially supporting them to stay there. So if you're not willing to get out of Bowling Green or Warren County, then we need to support the missionaries that are in our state, the missionaries that are in our country, and the missionaries that are in our world. See how this works? And that's what's beautiful about the Southern Baptist Convention, because we all band together, 45,000 churches strong, and we all collectively give towards these avenues. Now, and that's what makes it so dynamic, is when we see a missionary in the field, our money, our dollars put him there. Your tithe puts them there. And you can give above and beyond, like the offerings that we talked about in the giving segment, is those offerings help them stay there. And so this is important that we realize the charge when it comes to missions, sending. We are to go, like it says in Matthew 28, and in Acts 1:8, it says, as we go pretty much in life. And in Romans 10, it talks about that proclamation. So as we go, we are to share, we are to make disciples. And if we're not going to various places in the world, various countries, various counties, various locations, then we are to help support them. That's a big, big, big challenge. That's why we all have to step up to the plate. We all have to be sharing. Can you see the big picture? Now, here's what we have to do. If we want to have a good missiology, that approach to proclaiming the gospel and to go and to share the gospel with others, we have to do a couple of things. One, we have to know God. People that make those shallow responses about missions, it's obviously that they do not know God at the level that they need to know God. I mean, we see all throughout the Old Testament, again, I wish I had time, all throughout the Old Testament where God is sending his people out to bless all those. I mean, they're a kingdom of priests, right? They're mediators between God and the people. And that is a charge that God made back then. You know, and you know how the Jewish people responded? Here's a great one. That story about Jonah? He didn't want to go to Nineveh because he hated Nineveh. All Jews hated Nineveh. And God had a special plan for him, right? We are all called to go. We don't need to be running from that call, but we need to know God. The more we know God, the more we study his word, the more we see his desire for his mercy to go out, we take a new view for missions, a new view for making disciples, a new view for sharing our faith. We are to know the beliefs of those around you. I've said this before, we have to know the people around us, their faith. I mean, how did it say in Romans that they are to know unless someone shares? And that responsibility, my friends, is upon you. So I would want, if you have a friend or a family member that you love and you care for, you need to ask them, are you a believer in Jesus Christ? Because you need to know how to proceed after that. We also see that you need to know where you can connect. You know, where are places that you can connect with? You know, to share the gospel as you serve, as you're with family. You know, would you be willing to go on a mission trip? Now, when I say mission trip, hear these words. I'm saying a place to go to proclaim the gospel. Proclaim the gospel. Is there a place that you would be willing to go and proclaim the gospel? Would you be willing to go overseas to proclaim the gospel? Next thing is, besides the proclaiming, who could you support on the mission field? How can you give a tour to those who are on the field? You need to know too, you need to realize that you are empowered by the Holy Spirit. You might be scared, but you know what? That spirit that's in you can do more than you could ever imagine. Why? Because it's God. God can do all things, right? God can give us the strength. That's why at Pentecost we see the Spirit going into the disciples to be able to empower them to do ministry. That's how it works with us, is the Spirit empowers us to do ministry. And we need to look for advantages to share. We got to be sharing our faith, guys. We treat our faith so shallowly at times because we just go, what do we have to do to be a Christian? And we'll say, well, we need to go to church. We'll need to go to Sunday school. We need to give. We need to be baptized. You know, you say those kind of in the box kind of cookie cutter type answers. But guys, about a tool in our shed that needs to be sharpened and put into use is that tool of us making disciples and proclaiming the gospel to those around us. I mean, really think about it. How often do we see people around us doing that? Not much. It's easy for us to say somebody else can do it and blame somebody else. It's somebody else's fault why it's not heard. Well, it is our responsibility to go. That imperative that's in Matthew 28, it doesn't say just the apostles. It doesn't say just the disciples. It doesn't say just pastors. It doesn't say just ministers or missionaries or teachers. It says everybody. We are all to have this charge. We are all to make that difference. Like the Romans passage says, how can they know unless they hear? How can they hear? But from people like us. Think about it. Really let that sink in. How's that tool look in your shed? Is it sharp? Is it used? Do you know how to swing it? Do you know how to use it? Many of us don't. So I challenge you to think about this. How are you going to make a difference? How are you going to be sent? There's lots of people that need to know God. Let's pray. Father God, Lord, I just pray that we can take this weight upon us to realize there's people around us that don't know you. And whose responsibility is it to share the gospel? Us. By all means, us. Lord, there's many people that are called to go to the field and that are in the field right now serving you, sharing and proclaiming your name. Help us not to forget them. They take such a sacrifice by giving it all. They're not able to see their family as much. They have to fight sicknesses. They have to fight rebellions. They have to fight all kinds of problems just to share the gospel. And may we realize that them being there is a sacrifice to proclaim the gospel. They're not going there just to do basic labor. They're going there to share the gospel. And so, Lord, I pray that we dig deep to support these missionaries, dig deep to pray hard, dig deep to encourage them, and dig deep to financially give to them. Father God, we just love you so much. And I just pray that no one that heard this message tonight will build up a wall and get offended or feel that I'm stepping on their toes, Lord, but they see the charge that your scripture lays out, that we are to preach the gospel and make disciples, each and every one of us. So, Father God, may we take that to heart, and may we have spiritual eyes to look at the needs around us, be it here in Warren County, in Kentucky, in our nation, or our world. May we never be scared. May we always be courageous. We love you, Lord, so much. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. I hope you guys have a great night, and thank you for joining us. Next time, we will be talking about fellowship, that community of the body of believers. Well, you guys have a great night, and I look forward to our next time.